to you by Penguin. Many years ago, I saw in Bath a very large American lady towing a huge tartan suitcase very fast on little rattly wheels which caught in the pavement cracks and generally gave it a life of its own. At that moment, the luggage was born. Many thanks to that lady and everyone else in places like Power Cable, Nebraska, who don't get nearly enough encouragement. This book does not contain a map. Please feel free to draw your own.
Sourcery by Terry Pratchett. Read by Colin Morgan with Bill Nighy and Peter Serafinowicz. There was a man, and he had 8 sons. Apart from that, he was nothing more than a comma on the page of history. It's sad, but that's all you can say about some people. But the 8th son grew up and married and had 8 sons. And because there is only one suitable profession for the 8th son of an 8th son, he became a wizard. And he became wise and powerful, or at any rate, powerful, and wore a pointed hat, and there it would have ended. Should have ended. But against the lore of magic, and certainly against all reason, except the reasons of the heart, which are warm and messy and, well, unreasonable, he fled the halls of magic and fell in love and got married, not necessarily in that order. And he had 7 sons, each one from the cradle at least as powerful as any wizard in the world. And then he had an 8th son, a wizard squared, a source of magic, a sorcerer. Summer thunder rolled around the sandy cliffs. Far below, the sea sucked on the shingle as noisily as an old man with one tooth who'd been given a gobstopper. A few seagulls hung lazily in the updrafts, waiting for something to happen. And the father of wizards sat among the thrift and rattling sea grasses at the edge of the cliff, cradling the child in his arms, staring out to sea. There was a roil of black cloud out there, heading inland, and the light it pushed before it had that deep syrup quality it gets before a really serious thunderstorm. He turned at a sudden silence behind him, and looked up through tear-reddened eyes at a tall hooded figure in a black robe.
"Ipslaw the Red,"
it said. The voice was as hollow as a cave, as dense as a neutron star. Ipslaw grinned the terrible grin of the suddenly mad and held up the child for Death's inspection.
"My son," he said. "I shall call him Coin."
"A name as good as any other,"
said Death politely. His empty sockets stared down at a small round face wrapped in sleep. Despite rumour, Death isn't cruel, merely terribly, terribly good at his job.
"You took his mother,"
said Ipslaw. It was a flat statement, without apparent rancour. In the valley behind the cliffs, Ipslaw's homestead was a smoking ruin, the rising wind already spreading the fragile ashes across the hissing dunes.
"It was a heart attack at the end,"
said Death.
"There are worse ways to die. Take it from me."
Ipslaw looked out to sea.
All my magic could not save her, he said.
There are places where even magic may not go.
And now you have come for the child?
No, the child has his own destiny. I have come for you.
Ah.
The wizard stood up, carefully led the sleeping baby down on the thin grass, and picked up a long staff that had been lying there. It was made of a black metal, with a meshwork of silver and gold carvings that gave it a rich and sinister tastelessness. The metal was oct iron, intrinsically magical.
I made this, you know, he said. They all said you couldn't make a staff out of metal. They said they should only be of wood, but they were wrong. I put a lot of myself into it. I shall give it to him.
He ran his hands lovingly along the staff, which gave off a faint tone. He repeated, almost to himself,
I put a lot of myself into it.
It is a good staff,
said Death. Ipsor held it in the air and looked down at his eighth son, who gave a gurgle.
She wanted a daughter, he said.
Death shrugged. Ipsor gave him a look compounded of bewilderment and rage.
What is he?
The eighth son of an eighth son of an eighth son,
said Death unhelpfully. The wind whipped at his robe, driving the black clouds overhead.
What does that make him?
A sorcerer, as you are well aware.
Thunder rolled on cue.
What is his destiny?
Shouted Ipslor above the rising gale. Death shrugged again. He was good at it.
Sorcerers make their own destiny. They touch the earth lightly.
Ipslor leaned on the staff, drumming on it with his fingers, apparently lost in the maze of his own thoughts. His left eyebrow twitched.
No,
he said softly.
No. I will make his destiny for him.
I advise against it.
Be quiet and listen when I tell you that they drove me out with their books and their rituals and their lore. They call themselves wizards, and they had less magic in their whole fat bodies than I have in my little finger. Banished? Me? For showing that I was human? And what would humans be without love?
Rare,
said Death.
Nevertheless.
Listen! They drove us here to the ends of the world, and that killed her. They tried to take my staff away!
Ipsor was screaming above the noise of the wind.
Well, I still have some power left,
he snarled.
And I say that my son shall go to Unseen University and wear the Arch-Chancellor's hat, and the wizards of the world shall bow to him, and he shall show them what lies in their deepest hearts, their craven, greedy hearts. He'll show the world its true destiny, and there will be no magic greater than his.
No.
And the strange thing about the quiet way Death spoke the word was this. It was louder than the roaring of the storm. It jerked Ipslor back to momentary sanity. Ipslor rocked back and forth uncertainly.
What?
He said.
I said no. Nothing is final. Nothing is absolute. Except me, of course. Such tinkering with destiny could mean the downfall of the world. There must be a chance, however small. The lawyers of fate demand a loophole in every prophecy.
Ipsnor stared at Death's implacable face.
I must give them a chance?
Yes.
Tap, tap, tap went Ipsnor's fingers on the metal of the staff.
Then they shall have their chance, he said. When hell freezes over?
No, I am not allowed to enlighten you, even by default, about current temperatures in the next world.
Then,
Ipslor hesitated,
then they shall have their chance when my son throws his staff away.
No wizard, would ever throw his staff away,
said Death.
The bond is too great.
Yet it is possible, you must agree.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.